Okay, so we are here in Toronto, Canada, and I am talking to a very prestigious person from Cape Town. He traveled a long time to get here to Toronto. Can you tell us your name and your where you work in Cape Town, South Africa?
Oh yes, thank you for having me. My name is Katleho Limakatso, from South Africa in Cape Town, affiliated to the Department of Anesthesia and Perioperative Medicine at the University of Cape Town.
Yeah. And he traveled 24 hours, many flights to get here to Canada.
Yep, a long journey indeed.
So can you tell me a little bit about your special interest in pain?
100%, yes. I have a special interest in understanding the mechanisms that underlie post-surgical pain syndromes, particularly phantom limb pain in people with amputations. So my interest, as I've mentioned, is understanding the mechanisms that underlie phantom limb pain and also design treatments that may be effective for reducing
so phantom
limb pain.
Okay, so phantom limb pain, for those of who don't know, person has an amputation and it's missing a part, but they continue having pain in the part that is missing.
That is missing.
And you want to know what is the mechanism for this. So what did you find?
Quite interesting findings, really. So what we have seen, in fact, it's a theory that has been tested at the moment, is that there is a stochastic entanglement of sensory motor networks.
In the brain?
Yes, within the pain neuroaxis from the spinal cord level up.
So there
to
is a kind
the
of
brain.
A, what do you mean entanglement? So they are kind of a short circuits that go in the pathways?
So entanglement in such a way that there is what we refer to as Hebb's law, meaning stating that neurons that fire together, they wire together.
That's neuroplasticity, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, I already mentioned this in my channel, yeah.
Yep, so neurons that fire together, wire together. So when you have an entanglement of sensory, motor, and pain networks, when motor networks are activated, then pain networks are also activated.
Okay.
That's why we get to see patients when they imagine movements, they also experience the perception of pain. When they imagine movement on or when
just
they
just thinking about moving a part of the body, that will be a short circuit because the movement is not painful.
Yep.
But then it will activate the other pathway and they would interpret that as pain.
Absolutely, because now these networks have been entangled. So that seems to be a plausible theory for phantom limb pain at this moment. So the treatments that work to reduce phantom limb pain, they work towards entangling such networks.
Disentangling.
Yeah, disentangling.
How do you undo that thing?
Because if neurons that fire, that wire together, or that fire together, wire together, that means that the inverse of that law would work in terms of reducing phantom limb pain, meaning we need to provide treatments that fire motor networks below a certain threshold without activating pain networks.
And how do you do that as a physiotherapist? What exactly do you do that in practice? What do you tell the person?
So graded motor imagery is a treatment that seems to be working.
Can you explain what is graded motor imagery?
Yeah. So graded motor imagery is a sequence of strategies including left-right judgments, imagined movements.
So you look the right hand and you have two seats right, okay?
Absolutely. So during the left-right judgments, there is an app that we use. So if you are, if your arm has been amputated, then we will project photos of arms, left and right arms, quite equally and evenly so. Then the patient will get a chance to choose whether the shown arm represents the left or the right
and
side.
And this is retraining the pain system? I talk a lot in my channel about retraining the pain system.
Absolutely. So what we have seen through the MRI studies that have been done is that such laterality tasks, they address changes in the primary sensory cortex.
Okay, you're talking to a language that is too complicated. So you were saying that the right brain and the left side, they talk to each other, and this information going from one side to another one mm-hmm. is important to change, to undo those short circuits that happened?
Not necessarily so. We're not at that stage. So this is more of a preparatory stage, yeah. the first one, because what we have seen is that patients with amputations, they have poor left-right judgment.
Of the place that was amputated, or like if they had an amputation of the leg, mm-hmm. would they also have a poor judgment of the hands too, or no?
Oh, no. The affected limb.
Only the affected limb. If they had a right leg amputation, and you show pictures of right and left foot, mm-hmm. they have difficulty identifying what is right, what is left.
Absolutely. Mm. And then we have two outcome measures that we look at in that instance. So the first one is accuracy. So what we have seen is that they have poor accuracy in determining the sightedness of the affected limb. Okay, so let me say, for example, if they've been amputated on the left limb, they get it quite wrong. So they have poor laterality in that sense, but also time that it takes for them to recognize the affected limb.
It takes longer for them to get it.
Absolutely, it takes them longer to recognize the affected limb relative to the unaffected.
So then showing them these pictures, do you see benefits for the phantom limb pain that they were having?
Absolutely. So this, as I've mentioned, is a preparatory stage for us to get them performing phantom motor executions.
Oh, okay.
Because the basis of the treatment is for them to move the phantom limb, but it'll be difficult for them to move the phantom limb if they don't know what's left and what's right.
Okay.
So we retrain the left and right judgments so that we can prepare them for movement, which leads to the second stage of the treatment. So before they execute movement, we get them to imagine movements.
Just thinking about moving that part that is missing.
Absolutely. So this activates motor networks below a threshold that would usually trigger a painful response.
What if they are doing this exercise and they feel pain?
It's seldom happens, especially with imagined movements.
Okay.
It seldom happens, but sometimes they do experience pain. And one of my one of the things that I've seen in clinical practice is that instead of imagining moving the phantom limb, sometimes they are in fact moving the phantom limb. So let's be careful of the wording there.
Okay, I don't know what you mean. So you were saying that there's a difference between imagining mm-hmm. the movement and actually moving. But if they don't have the foot anymore, how can they actually move it?
Absolutely. So with you and I, if I was to ask you to imagine extending your knee.
Okay, I'm imagining now.
You would imagine it. Mm. And you are giving me feedback that you've imagined such movement, but nothing happened here.
No.
But if I ask you to move your leg, mm-hmm. you've moved it,
yeah.
and confirmation that you've moved it comes from your visual feedback.
Yeah.
You've seen that limb move. So with people with amputations, they can perform both tasks. Of imagining movement,
okay, and then activate
but
the muscle.
Also moving the phantom limb. But the problem with moving the phantom limb is that
there
is no visual input. You can't see it. But there are several tests that I use in clinical practice to monitor that. So during the imagined movement phase, what I do, you just patch them up with EMG feedback.
Mm-hmm.
So when they imagine
EMG
movement,
feedback means electrodes in the skin that measure how much muscle activation is
in the stump area.
Okay.
So when they imagine movement purely without moving the phantom limb, there won't be any activation or reading on the EMG feedback.
Quiet. So they're just imagining, so there's no actual
Absolutely.
Muscle.
So when they perform motor execution instead of imagining movement, then the reading will pop up. So that's when you'd stop them to say, we are not moving as yet. Please imagine, purely imagine moving your phantom limb instead of moving it. So to answer your question, patients tend to experience pain when they jump phases, when they execute movement instead of imagining movement.
So you want
first.
Them to imagine first.
Mm.
And how long does it take for this training?
So the current protocol that we have for this treatment is about 6 weeks.
Okay.
So 2 weeks per phase, 2 weeks for left-right judgments, 2 weeks for imagined movement exercises, and 2 weeks for mirror therapy exercises.
The mirror means they're moving, and they see in the mirror, they see the good, that side that they have, the limb.
Yep.
And but their brain thinks that they are seeing both.
Absolutely. So with mirror, exactly how you describe it, the amputated limb is hidden behind the mirror, and then the intact limb is in front of the mirror. So you perform exercises both with the intact limb and the phantom limb behind
at
the mirror,
the same time, and then
while viewing the reflection of the intact limb in the mirror. So the most important aspect of this treatment is movement of the phantom limb behind the mirror. Because what we have seen is that initially we believed that the visual feedback from the mirror was the therapeutic component. But studies have shown that compared to mirror therapy and covered mirror therapy, the results were the same.
Which means that it's more than sensation, the proprioception, what's coming from the brain, the messages from the muscles to the brain.
Absolutely. Okay. It's more of the phantom motor execution that seems to be a therapeutic component more than the vision.
Yeah.
But vision, it's important in a sense that it helps you to facilitate movement.
Yeah.
The example that I usually use with my patients is that if you can walk with your eyes closed, yes, you can walk, but it's certainly easier to walk with your eyes open.
Yeah.
You see that? So vision facilitates movement in
this
that sense.
This is so fascinating because this shows that we can revert this entanglement, those short circuits, right?
Absolutely.
And tell me, is it better if we do this therapy, this 6 weeks treatment, right after they had the amputation, or do we wait until they develop this chronic pain? And or how? What if a person had this chronic pain for years? Do you think that would make a difference if we do this treatment many years after the amputation, or is it better to do sooner after the amputation? Do you have any data about that?
Sooner. We currently do not have any data, but I'm just going to, from clinical reasoning, sooner. In fact, there is data for conditions such as complex regional pain syndrome that created motor imagery is more effective when applied sooner.
So that's good, because you mentioned CRPS, complex regional pain syndrome. I have a video about CRPS on my channel.
Yeah.
And so do you think that if we could do the same three phases for treatment of CRPS?
Yeah, 100%. In fact, created motor imagery was primarily designed for the management of CRPS, but after comparing the mechanisms underlying CRPS and phantom limb pain, that's when I conducted a randomized controlled trial in addition to the study that Mosley conducted back in 2006 to determine whether GMI would be effective for reducing phantom limb pain, and the results were really interesting and fascinating. So in years to come, in fact from next year, we are going to conduct a much bigger trial to investigate the effectiveness of this treatment a bit further.
Oh, that's fantastic. So thank you for talking to me today, and I was so lucky to meet you today at the conference, the World Congress of Pain. And talk to you about your very interesting research about phantom limb pain, and explain to us again the retraining of the pain system, that it is possible, and this is one treatment takes 6 weeks. It doesn't seem too complicated, and we could be reducing pain medications that they use,
absolutely
returning them to function. And if it doesn't work, could they repeat this? Or because I guess it doesn't work for every single patient that you try. Could they repeat this 6 weeks or try a little longer each phase?
We don't have any data in terms of trying it for a bit longer. We know that during that 6 weeks, most of our patients do recover.
They get a good benefit in 6 weeks?
Absolutely. And even up to, we've monitored their progress up to 6 months. So we know that even after 6 months, the patients are still pretty well. But as a clinician in this case, if a patient doesn't benefit from this treatment, there are other promising treatments that could potentially help. So one of the treatments that my colleagues in Sweden are working on is a surgical intervention, which is really gaining popularity mainly because of its effectiveness. It's called targeted muscle reinnervation, TMR. So what they do is to, it can be used as a prophylaxis for the prevention of phantom limb pain, but it can also be used as a treatment for phantom limb pain. So the basis of that treatment is to prevent a formation of a neuroma. So what they do is that they take a sensory nerve that has been severed during an amputation, and then they attach it to an already existing branch of a motor nerve. So that way, by attaching these nerves together, then a neuroma
is a little tumor of the nerve, because when there is an amputation, they cut the nerves, and that nerve ending that just finished there can create this little tumor. It's a little like a growing of the nerve.
Yep.
So you mean instead of just leaving it there hanging there, you connect to another nerve
to give it purpose, to give it function.
To give a function.
Yeah. So if it functions, it won't develop a neuroma,
which can be very painful, because the neuroma is a pain in this thumb, the part that has still remaining. And I have some patients that you touch and you tap and then it hurts, or they try to use the prosthesis and it hurts. So they try to move and it hurts because it's pressing the neuroma, and they have those sharp stabbing pain and electrical shocks, which is really hard to treat.
Absolutely.
So you've
said it so well.
So that's fascinating. Thank you so much for talking to me today.
It is a pleasure. Thank you.